Hi everyone, I'm Matt Yossi. In this talk I'm going to introduce you to SEAP, a set of modifications to the Android Open Source project to extend mandatory access control to third-party applications. Let me start by discussing our motivation. As applications grow in size and complexity, it is harder to keep track of which component access sensitive data. While Android has great success in the isolation of apps, all components running inside the application fall into the same sandbox. This induces some problems. For example, when the user grants access find location to the application, a third-party advertisement framework running in the same app can access GPS location and track the user. And this is just one of the use cases we identified. In general, we want to control the ability of every component to access the application internal storage. Then we want to have guarantees that third-party libraries cannot abuse the permission given to the application, and also we want to enable the isolation of large and complex vulnerability-prone components. For example, the ones relying on native libraries. In other words, we were looking for a way to enable internal app compartmentalization. When we were designing SEAP, it was clear that the solution had to be as transparent as possible to users and developers, as we didn't want app developers to change the way they develop and build their apps. So SEAP had to comply with the current Android security model and be compatible even with applications that do not use it. In order to do so, we came up with the following idea. First, separate components into different processes, then regulate the permissions associated with each process, introducing ad hoc Linux domains. As you might know, the first step can already be done using the Android process tag in the manifest, while the second part is more tricky because we need a way to enter app-specific policy modules, we need install time support to validate and load the modules, but also runtime support to enforce the policies. To enter app-specific policy module, we ask developers interested in using SEAP to provide the policy module inside their APKs. The policy module is a folder named policy containing four files: the file context, which is a listing of opath and type assignments, and mappermissions.xml, representing the same info tag assignments to the app. The SEAP context, a listing of process and domain assignments, and sepolicy.seal, which is the actual application policy the developer wants to install. For those of you familiar with SeAndroid, you may have noticed that this structure resembles the organization of system policy configuration files. Now, can we specify the policy? How can we specify the policy? For that, we have selected a subset of the common intermediate language. Within this policy dialect, there are two groups of statements. The one we need to declare types and grant permissions, where we have the type attribute set, allow, and call statements. And the one we use to limit the propagation of permissions, where we have the block and the type-bound statements. This second group comes into play to ensure policy modules satisfy the following security requirements. First, the overall consistency of the Linux policy must be preserved, or rather, the system policy must not change due to the introduction of a policy module. Then, each policy module must have an impact only on processes and the resources associated with the app itself. These requirements must be enforced both at install time and runtime. In order to translate this high-level definition to actual policy constraints, we use the concept of origin. A type origin is determined at install time thanks to the block statement, which we use to wrap each policy module in a unique namespace equal to the package name. The use of types defined by the other policy modules is prohibited, while other types are classified as local type, when the type is defined within the policy module, and system type, when it is defined outside it. Let's see how the concept of origin applies to the most common AVU, the allow statement. Well, based on the origin of source and target, there are four cases. Allow SS, which represents a direct policy modification, and it is therefore denied. Allow AA, that grants privileges to resources associated within the app, and it is permitted. Allow AS, which occurs when a local type needs to be granted a permission on a system type. This is granted, but we must ensure local type privileges are bounded to untrusted app, to avoid escalating privileges beyond what a normal app has. Finally, we have allow SA, which occurs when a system type is granted privileges on a local type. This is necessary as we need to provide interoperability with system types, but may not be safe as it may lead to a confused deputy attack, changing the security assumption of a system service. So we deny its explicit use, but since we need it, we provide a safer alternative, which are macros. Macros are better because they add a predefined set of policy statements, which let the system policy retain control on the system types involved in the policy module, as they cannot be edited or changed by the developer. Macros are also better because they abstract away system policy internals, so a developer aiming to write a policy doesn't need to know how C100 works. There are multiple checks executed by a compiler. A full dissertation can be found in our paper or in the repository. Now I leave the floor to Dario for the presentation of install time and runtime support.
Thanks, Matthew. Here we can see the overall picture of install time support. Each time a C app is installed, the policy module is extracted and validated by the package manager service. It is combined with all the other policy fragments on device, the new Selinux binary policy compiled with CSilk, and finally the policy is reloaded by installd. With regard to runtime support, we need to ensure processes are labeled according to the policy. We therefore implemented some changes in Zygote, which is the native service that spawns and sets up new application processes. As you can see from the figure, a new step was introduced to set the domain according to the local CApp context, just before the logic of the process kicks in. If no information from the local CApp context is available, the system CApp context is used as a fallback. The security context of files is set upon creation, according to the content of the local file context. To do that, we introduced a new system service called RestoreCon. The call to the RestoreCon service is transparently handled by android.os.file, a new API with the same interface of java.io.file. This implementation strategy has several advantages, including backward compatibility, support to regexp via file context, no performance impact on applications that aren't using CApp, and of course, we still support file labeling based on inheritance of parent type. We also had to modify the startup procedure to make sure that policy modules are available after boot. We recall that, since Project Treble, each time a policy segment changes, an on-device compilation is required. Thus, we needed to integrate the policy modules accordingly. For that, the second stage in ETRC was modified to mount data partition only. Data is where we decided to store the policy modules. And immediately after that, a call to a new built-in function that builds and reloads the policy is performed. By doing this, we make sure the policy module is not bypassable, since the modules are loaded before any application starts. We also conducted some experiments to measure the overhead introduced. Install time overhead measures the slowdown that occurs during app installation. To measure it, we downloaded the most popular 150 free applications from Google Play, classified them into basic, ordinary, and huge buckets, and accordingly, we equipped the apps with three synthetic policy configurations. As expected, the overhead grows with the number of installed policy modules, and of course, with the complexity of policy modules. The experimental results show that Only the use of huge policy modules introduces a non-negligible overhead. However, this policy configuration simulates an edge case as huge policy declares 100 types, approximately a third of the types declared by the system to label files. Since we are short in time, please refer to our paper for the details. We also measure the runtime overhead affecting processes and file creation. Summing up, the good news is that compared to the stock OS, overhead related to process creation is negligible, while file creation overhead is approximately 370 microseconds, and this is due to the call to the RestoreScan service performed by android.os.file. Again, please refer to the paper for the details. To conclude, our work is publicly available on GitHub. You can also find there the material we used to pass the artifact evaluation process and the implementation of a security enhanced app. The security enhanced app showcases how CAP can be used to reduce access to internal storage, restrict access to system services, and isolate components relying on native library. These are also our contacts. Any questions are welcome. Thank you for the attention.